गुड आफ्टरनून, आवाज येतोय माझा? हॅलो,
यस मॅम,
यस मॅम.
ओके. So as we are dealing with preventive medicine, obstetrics and gynec, so today we'll start with a new topic, family planning. So what is the exact definition of family planning? An expert committee in 1971 of WHO defined family planning as it is a way of thinking and living that is adopted voluntarily upon the basis of knowledge, attitudes, and responsible decision by individuals and couples in order to promote the health and welfare of family group and thus contribute effectively to the social development of country. So family planning is a way of thinking and living that is adopted voluntarily upon the basis of knowledge, attitudes, and responsible decision by individuals and couples in order to promote health and welfare of family group and thus contributes effectively to the social development of country. So another expert committee defined and described family planning as follows. Like, family planning refers to the practices that helps individual or couples to attain certain objectives. The objectives are to avoid unwanted births, to bring about wanted births, to regulate the intervals between pregnancies, to control the time at which birth occurs in relation to the ages of the parent and to determine the number of children in the family. So family planning refers to the practices that helps individuals or couples to attain certain objectives. That objectives are to avoid unwanted births, to bring about wanted births, to regulate the intervals between pregnancies, to control the time at which birth occur in relation to ages of parent, and to determine the number of children in the family. So basic human rights. So family planning is the basic human right. The United Nations Conference on Human Rights at Tehran in 1968 recognized that the family planning as a basic human right. The Bucharest Conference on the World Population held in August 1974 endorsed the same view and stated in its plan of action that all couples and individuals have the basic human right to decide freely and responsibly the number and spacing of their children and to have the information, education, and means to do so. So what they stated, all couples and individuals have the basic human right to decide freely and responsibly the number and spacing of their children, and to have the information, education, and means to do so. The World Conference of the International Women's Year in the 1975 also declared the right of women to decide freely and responsibly on the number and spacing of their children, and to have the access to information and means to enable them to exercise that right. Thus, during the past few decades, family planning has emerged from the whispers to private quarters to the focus of international concern as a basic human right and a component of family health and social welfare. So the family planning is the basic human right. And what is the scope of family planning services? Family planning is not synonymous with birth control. It is more than mere a birth control. A WHO expert committee in 1970 has stated that family planning includes in its preview what that the purpose, spacing, and limitation of the purpose, spacing, and limitation of births, advice on sterility, education for parenthood, sex education, screening for pathological conditions related to the reproductive system, for example, cervical cancer, and genetic counseling. So it is not about only birth control, it is about other previews also, like the proper spacing and limitations of birth, advice on sterility, education for parenthood, sex education, screening for pathological conditions related to the reproductive system, for example, cervical cancer, and genetic counseling. All these things are included in family planning. Others also there, like premarital consultation and examination, carrying out pregnancy tests, marriage counselings, the preparation of couples for the arrival of their first child, providing services for unmarried mothers, teaching home economics and nutrition, and providing adoption services. All these are also included in family planning. That is premarital consultation and examination, carrying out pregnancy tests, marriage counseling, the preparation of couples for the arrival of their first child, providing services for unmarried mothers, teaching home economics and nutrition, and providing adoption services. All these activities vary from country to country according to national objectives and policies with regard to family planning. And this is the modern concept of family planning. It can be asked for 5 marks, the modern concept of family planning. So these 13 points should be included. Then what is the health aspect of family planning? The principal health outcomes of family planning were listed and discussed by WHO scientific group on the health aspects of family planning. This can be summarized under the following headings, like women's health, fetal health, and infant and child health. So health aspects are summarized in women's health, fetal health, infant and child health. We'll see one by one. So first one is women's health. So pregnancy can mean serious problems for many women. It may damage the mother's health or even endanger her life. Family planning, by intervening in the reproductive cycle of women, helps them to control the number, interval, and timing of pregnancy and births, and thereby reduces maternal mortality, morbidity, and improves the health of mother. So family planning helps her in a reproductive cycle of woman. It helps them to control the number, interval, and timing of pregnancies and births, and thereby reduces maternal mortality, morbidity, and improves their health. The health impact of family planning occurs primarily through the avoidance of unwanted pregnancies, limiting the number of births and proper spacing, and timing the births, particularly the first and last, in relation to the age of mother. So it impacts on the avoidance of unwanted pregnancies, limiting the number of births and proper spacing, timing of birth, particularly the first and last, in relation to the age of mother. It is estimated that guaranteeing access to the family planning alone could reduce the number of maternal deaths by 25%. And child mortality by 20%. So proper planning is needed. So first one is unwanted pregnancies. So the essential aim of family planning is to prevent the unwanted pregnancies. An unwanted pregnancy may lead to an induced abortion. From the point of view of health, abortion outside the medical setting, which is called as criminal abortion, is one of the most dangerous consequences of unwanted pregnancy. So the aim of family planning is to prevent unwanted pregnancy, because this unwanted pregnancy can lead to induced abortion, and it is also called as criminal abortion. Then limiting the number of births and proper spacing. Repeated pregnancies increases the risk of maternal mortality and morbidity also. The incidence of rupture of uterus and uterine attorney increases with parity, as does the incidence of toxemia, eclampsia, and placenta previa. So the incidence of rupture of uterus and uterine attorney increases with the parity, and also the incidence of toxemia, eclampsia, and placenta previa is also increases with parity. Anemia is the common problem in mothers with many children, and the rate of stillbirths tend to increase significantly with high parity. The somatic consequence of repeated pregnancies may also be exemplified in the clear association between incidence of cancer of the cervix and high parity. So family planning is the only way to limit the size and control the interval between births with the view to improving the health of mother. So if there is a repeated pregnancy, it increases the risk of maternal mortality and morbidity. It can increase the incidence of rupture of uterus and uterine atony. It can increase the incidence of toxemia, eclampsia, and placenta previa. It can cause the conditions like anemia. The rate of stillbirth can increase with high parity. It can increase the incidence of cancer of cervix. So for all this, family planning is the only way to limit the size and control of interval between births. Then timing of births. Generally, mothers face greater risk of dying below the age of 20 and above the age of 30 to 35. So in many countries, complications of pregnancy and delivery show the same pattern of risk, with the highest rate below 20 and over 35 years of age. So the timing of the pregnancy, timing of the birth, it should be between 20 to 35. Then second health aspect is about fetal health. A number of congenital anomalies, for example Down syndrome, are associated with advancing maternal age. Such congenital anomalies can be avoided by timing the births in relation to the mother's age. And further, the quality of population can be improved only by avoiding completely unwanted births. So a number of congenital anomalies, for example Down syndrome, are associated with advancing maternal age. And such congenital anomalies can be avoided by timing the births in relation to mother's age. Then third one is the child health, in which first is child mortality. So it is well known that child mortality increases when pregnancies occur in rapid succession. A birth interval of 2 to 3 years is considered desirable to reduce the child mortality. So there should be a gap of or interval of 2 to 3 years in between two pregnancies to avoid or to reduce the child mortality. Second one is a child growth, development, and nutrition. So birth spacing and family size are important factor in child growth and development. The child is likely to receive his full share of love and care, including nutrition he needs, when the family size is small and births are properly spaced. So family planning, in other words, is effective in prevention against malnutrition. Then infectious diseases. Children living in large sized family have an increased incidence of infection, especially infectious gastroenteritis, respiratory and skin infections. Then next is the welfare concept. The concept of welfare is very comprehensive and is basically related to the quality of life. So the family welfare program aims at achieving a higher end, that is to improve the quality of life of the people. And it includes small family norm, eligible couples, target couples, and couple protection rate, that is CPR. The family welfare programs aims at achieving a higher end, that is to improve the quality of life of the people. And it includes small family norm, eligible couples, target couples, couple protection rate, that is CPR. So first one is a small family norm. Small differences in the family size will make a big difference in the birth rate. The objective of the family welfare program in India is that people should adopt small family norm to stabilize the country's population at the level of some 1,533 million by the year of 2050 AD. It is symbolized by the inverted red triangle. The program initially adopted the model of three-child family. So the small family norm, it is symbolized by the inverted red triangle. It can come as a MCQ question. So small family norm is symbolized by. So it is symbolized by inverted red triangle. The program initially adopted the model of three-child family. In the 1970s, the slogan was the famous Do Ya Teen Bas. And in the view of the seriousness of the situation, in 1980s, the campaign has advocated the two-child norm. And the current emphasis is on three themes. That is, son or daughters, two will do. Second child after 3 years, and universal immunization. The next one is the eligible couples. An eligible couple refers to a currently married couple wherein the wife is in the reproductive age, which is generally assumed to lie between the age of 15 and 45. An eligible couple refers to the currently married couple wherein the wife is in reproductive age, which is generally assumed to lie between the age of 15 and 45. And there will be at least 150 to 180 such couples per 1,000 population in India. These couples are in need of family planning services. About 20% of eligible couples are found in age group of 15 to 24 years. Now, on an average, 2.5 million couples are joining the reproductive group every year. The eligible couple register is the basic document for organizing family planning work. So an eligible couple refers to the currently married couple wherein the wife is in reproductive age and which is generally in between age of 15 and 45. then target couples. The term target couple was applied to the couples who have had 2 to 3 living children, and family planning was largely directed to such couples. The term target couple was applied to the couples who have 2 to 3 living children, and family planning was largely directed to the such couples. The definition of target couple has been gradually enlarged to include families with one child or even newly married couples, with a view to develop acceptance of the idea of family planning from the earliest possible stage. The term eligible couple is now more widely used and has come to stay. And the last one is the couple protection rate, that is CPR. The couple protection rate is an indicator of the prevalence of contraceptive practice in the community. Couple protection rate is an indicator of the prevalence of contraceptive practice in the community. And it is defined as the percent of eligible couples effectively protected against childbirth by one or other approved methods of family planning, viz. Sterilization, IUD, condom, or oral pills. So couple protection rate is defined as the percent of eligible couples effectively protected against childbirth by one or other approved methods of family planning, like sterilization, IUD, condom, or oral pills. The sterilization accounts for over 60% of effectively protected couples. Demographers are of the view that demographic goal of NRR is 1 and can be achieved only if the CPR exceeds 60%. Thus, attaining the 60% of CPR will be equivalent to cutting off the almost all third or higher order of births, leaving 2 or less surviving children per couple. So next part will continue tomorrow. We'll revise in short today's part. So we have started with family planning. What is the exact definition of family planning? An expert committee in 1971 of WHO defined family planning as, it is a way of thinking and living that is adopted voluntarily upon the basis of knowledge, attitudes, and responsible decision by individuals and couples in order to promote the health and welfare of family group, and thus contribute effectively to the social development of country. So family planning is a way of thinking and living that is adopted voluntarily upon the basis of knowledge, attitudes and responsible decision by individuals and couples in order to promote health and welfare of family group, and thus contributes effectively to the social development of country. So another expert committee defined and described family planning as follows. Like, family planning refers to the practices that helps individual or couples to attain certain objectives. The objectives are to avoid unwanted births, to bring about wanted births, to regulate the intervals between pregnancies, to control the time at which birth occur in relation to the ages of the parent, and to determine the number of children in the family. So family planning refers to the practices that helps individuals or couples to attain certain objectives. That objectives are to avoid unwanted births, to bring about wanted births, to regulate the intervals between pregnancies, to control the time at which birth occur in relation to ages of parent, and to determine the number of children in the family. So basic human rights. So family planning is the basic human right. The United Nations Conference The United Nations Conference on Human Rights at Tehran in 1968 recognized that the family planning as a basic human right. The Bucharest Conference on the World Population held in August 1974 endorsed the same view and stated in its plan of action that all couples and individuals have the basic human right to decide freely and responsibly the number and spacing of their children, and to have the information, education, and means to do so. So what they stated, all couples and individuals have the basic human right to decide freely and responsibly the number and spacing of their children, and to have the information, education, and means to do so. The World Conference of the International Women's Year in the 1975 also declared the right of women to decide freely and responsibly on the number and spacing of their children, and to have the access to information and means to enable them to exercise that right. Thus, during the past few decades, family planning has emerged from the whispers to private quarters to the focus of international concern as a basic human right and a component of family health and social welfare. So the family planning is the basic human right. And what is the scope of family planning services? Family planning is not synonymous with birth control. It is more than mere a birth control. A WHO expert committee in 1970 has stated that family planning includes in its preview. What that? The purpose, spacing and limitation of the purpose, spacing and limitation of births, advice on sterility, education for parenthood, sex education, screening for pathological conditions related to the reproductive system, for example, cervical cancer, and genetic counseling. So it is not about only birth control, it is about other previews also, like the proper spacing and limitations of birth, advice on sterility, education for parenthood, sex education, screening for pathological conditions related to the reproductive system, for example, cervical cancer, and genetic counseling. All these things are included in family planning. Others also there, like premarital consultation and examination, carrying out pregnancy tests, marriage counselings, the preparation of couples for the arrival of their first child, providing services for unmarried mothers, teaching home economics and nutrition, and providing adoption services. All these are also included in family planning. That is premarital consultation and examination, carrying out pregnancy tests, marriage counseling, the preparation of couples for the arrival of their first child, providing services for unmarried mothers, teaching home economics and nutrition, and providing adoption services. All these activities vary from country to country according to national objectives and policies with regard to family planning. And this is the modern concept of family planning. It can be asked for 5 marks, the modern concept of family planning. So these 13 points should be included. Then what is the health aspect of family planning? The principal health outcomes of family planning were listed and discussed by WHO scientific group on the health aspects of family planning. This can be summarized under the following headings, like women's health, fetal health, and infant and child health. So health aspects are summarized in women's health, fetal health, infant and child health. We'll see one by one. So first one is women's health. So pregnancy can mean serious problems for many women. It may damage the mother's health or even endanger her life. Family planning, by intervening in the reproductive cycle of women, helps them to control the number, interval, and timing of pregnancy and births, and thereby reduces maternal mortality, morbidity, and improves the health of mother. So family planning helps her in a reproductive cycle of women. It helps them to control the number, interval, and timing of pregnancies and births, and thereby reduces maternal mortality, morbidity, and improves their health. The health impact of family planning occurs primarily through the avoidance of unwanted pregnancies, limiting the number of births and proper spacing, and timing the births, particularly the first and last, in relation to the age of mother. So it impacts on the avoidance of unwanted pregnancies, limiting the number of births and proper spacing, timing of birth, particularly the first and last in relation to the age of mother. It is estimated that guaranteeing access to the family planning alone could reduce the number of maternal deaths by 25% and child mortality by 20%. So proper planning is needed. So first one is unwanted pregnancies. So the essential aim of family planning is prevent the unwanted pregnancies. An unwanted pregnancy may lead to an induced abortion. From the point of view of health, abortion outside the medical setting, which is called as criminal abortion, is one of the most dangerous consequences of unwanted pregnancy. So the aim of family planning is to prevent unwanted pregnancy, because this unwanted pregnancy can lead to induced abortion, and it is also called as criminal abortion. Then limiting the number of births and proper spacing. Repeated pregnancies increases the risk of maternal mortality and morbidity also. The incidence of rupture of uterus and uterine attorney increases with parity, as does the incidence of toxemia, eclampsia, and placenta previa. So the incidence of rupture of uterus and uterine attorney increases with the parity, and also the incidence of toxemia, eclampsia, and placenta previa is also increases with parity. Anemia is the common problem in mothers with many children, and the rate of stillbirths tend to increase significantly with high parity. The somatic consequence of repeated pregnancies may also be exemplified in the clear association between incidence of cancer of the cervix and high parity. So family planning is the only way to limit the size and control the interval between births with the view to improving the health of mother. So if there is a repeated pregnancy, it increases the risk of maternal mortality and morbidity. It can increase the incidence of rupture of uterus and uterine attorney. It can increase the incidence of toxemia, eclampsia, and placenta previa. It can cause the conditions like anemia. The rate of stillbirth can increase with high parity. It can increase the incidence of cancer of cervix. So for all this, family planning is the only way to limit the size and control of interval between births. Then timing of births. Generally, mothers face greater risk of dying below the age of 20 and above the age of 30 to 35. So in many countries, complications of pregnancy and delivery show the same pattern of risk, with the highest rate below 20 and over 35 years of age. So the timing of the pregnancy, timing of the birth, it should be between 20 to 35. Then second health aspect is about fetal health. a number of congenital anomalies, for example Down syndrome, are associated with advancing maternal age. Such congenital anomalies can be avoided by timing the births in relation to the mother's age. And further, the quality of population can be improved only by avoiding completely unwanted births. So, a number of congenital anomalies, for example, Down syndrome, are associated with advancing maternal age. And such congenital anomalies can be avoided by timing the births in relation to mother's age. Then third one is the child health, in which first is child mortality. So it is well known that child mortality increases when pregnancies occur in rapid succession. A birth interval of 2 to 3 years is considered desirable to reduce the child mortality. So there should be a gap of or interval of 2 to 3 years in between two pregnancies to avoid or to reduce the child mortality. Second one is a child growth, development and nutrition. So birth spacing and family size are important factor in child growth and development. The child is likely to receive his full share of love and care, including nutrition he needs, when the family size is small and births are properly spaced. So family planning, in other words, is effective in prevention against malnutrition. Then infectious diseases. Children living in large sized family have an increased incidence of infection, especially infectious gastroenteritis, respiratory and skin infections. Then next is the welfare concept. The concept of welfare is very comprehensive and is basically related to the quality of life. So the family welfare program aims at achieving a higher end, that is to improve the quality of life of the people. And it includes small family norm, eligible couples, target couples, and couple protection rate, that is CPR. The family welfare programs aims at achieving a higher end, that is to improve the quality of life of the people. And it includes small family norm, eligible couples, target couples, couple protection rate, that is CPR. So first one is a small family norm. Small differences in the family size will make a big difference in the birth rate. The objective of the family welfare program in India is that people should adopt small family norm to stabilize the country's population at the level of some 1,533 million by the year of 2050 AD. It is symbolized by the inverted red triangle. The program initially adopted the model of three-child family. So the small family norm, it is symbolized by the inverted red triangle. It can come as a MCQ question. So small family norm is symbolized by. So it is symbolized by inverted red triangle. The program initially adopted the model of three child family. In the 1970s, the slogan was the famous Do Ya Teen Bus. And in the view of the seriousness of the situation, in 1980s, the campaign has advocated the two child norm. And the current emphasis is on three themes. That is, son or daughters, two will do. Second child after 3 years and universal immunization. The next one is the eligible couples. An eligible couple refers to a currently married couple wherein the wife is in the reproductive age, which is generally assumed to lie between the age of 15 and 45. An eligible couple refers to the currently married couple wherein the wife is in reproductive age, which is generally assumed to lie between the age of 15 and 45. And there will be at least 150 to 180 such couples per 1000 population in India. These couples are in need of family planning services. About 20% of eligible couples are found in age group of 15 to 24 years. Now, on an average, 2.5 million couples are joining the reproductive group every year. The eligible couple register is the basic document for organizing family planning work. So an eligible couple refers to the currently married couple wherein the wife is in reproductive age and which is generally in between age of 15 and 45. Then target couples. The term target couple was applied to the couples who have had 2 to 3 living children. And family planning was largely directed to such couples. The term target couple was applied to the couples who have 2 to 3 living children. And family planning was largely directed to the such couples. The definition of target couple has been gradually enlarged to include families with one child or even newly married couples with a view to develop acceptance of the idea of family planning from the earliest possible stage. The term eligible couple is now more widely used and has come to stay. And the last one is a couple protection rate, that is CPR. The couple protection rate is an indicator of the prevalence of contraceptive practice in the community. Couple protection rate is an indicator of the prevalence of contraceptive practice in the community. And it is defined as the percent of eligible couples effectively protected against childbirth by one or other approved methods of family planning. Wise sterilization, IUD, condom or oral pills. So couple protection rate is defined as the percent of eligible couples effectively protected against childbirth by one or other approved methods of family planning like sterilization, IUD, condom or oral pills. The sterilization accounts for over 60% of effectively protected couples. Demographers are of the view that demographic goal of NRR is 1 and can be achieved only if the CPR exceeds 60%. Thus, attaining the 60% of CPR will be equivalent to cutting off the almost all third or higher order of births, leaving 2 or less surviving children per couple. So next part will continue tomorrow. Thank you. If any doubt till here, you can call me or message me personally. Thank you.